Good morning and welcome to 10th Church. We're glad to have you here to worship with us. If you'd like to take your seats, we begin each morning worship service with a musical prelude. Before that, though, I'd like to read for us from a familiar psalm, Psalm 23, as we prepare our hearts for worship. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you. Good morning and welcome to 10th. If you're visiting, you're very warmly welcome to join us in worship today. If you take the order of service, you'll need that. We're going to be using it shortly. I'm going to read from Revelation chapter 15, and then we'll stand together to sing the doxology and to pray together using words you'll find in the bulletin there, and then we'll sing our opening hymn, which is number 77 in the hymn book. Well, let's hear the word of God from Revelation chapter 15. And I saw what appeared to be a sea of glass mingled with fire, and also those who had conquered the beast and its image and the number of its name standing beside the sea of glass with harps of God in their hands. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, Great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. Pray together using the words you'll find in the bulletin. O God, our Father, you are our creator, and we are the work of your hands. You are our shepherd, and we are your flock. You are our redeemer, and we are the people you have brought back. We have sinned against you and against others. We repent of all our sins and ask for your forgiveness. We pray that you would not remain angry with us, that you would not recall our sin to punish it, but that you would continue the work you have begun in us by your Spirit, that the whole earth may recognize that you are God, our Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we thank you that in your great mercy you do hear the prayers of your people and you pardon our sin for Jesus' sake. We come to you as our Father this morning. Oh yes, as our Creator who made all things, as our Redeemer in Christ, but as our Father by adoption. Thank you that you've made us your children. Help us to come boldly into your presence today. Coming to the throne of grace to find help in our time of need. We pray that you would draw near to us and give us that wonderfully feeling sense that we are in your presence today. We ask in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Thank you. be seated. Before we go to prayer, I'd like to remind you to be praying for those items in the bulletin that are noted each week for prayer, those who have individual concerns for medical help and assistance, as well as a number of the other ministries of the church. If we'd be praying for those in your Bible studies and your family devotions and your individual devotions, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our great God and Heavenly Father, we do rejoice that we have this privilege to come to you by faith into your presence. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And truly, we do rejoice in all of your great favors and blessings upon us. We rejoice in this God, our God, that we have given praise to through this hymn, that he is the living God. He hears, he speaks, he knows all things, and we can come to one who is not distant from us, but who is one who is drawn near to us. We thank you, as we have also affirmed in our statement, that he is the Creator God. We look about us and we see all of creation, the wonders of it, and we would proclaim, even of all of your handiwork, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name for all of his deeds and acts of mercy. The heavens declare the glory of God. The firmament showeth forth his handiwork. And we've affirmed in our statement, too, that you are the Redeemer, the one who knew no sin but became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness in Jesus Christ. And we thank you for that Spirit, the one who affirms in our heart that these things are true and right, who witnesses in our hearts that we are yours and we are yours by faith. Draw near to us, we pray. Help us to draw near to you, believing in you and trusting in you in these areas. And this good gospel that we have received, we thank you for the ways that you are working that out in the midst and throughout the world today, from the rising of the sun on the east to the going down thereof later. We thank you for all those that we join together to give you praise, and we pray for those partners that particularly go out from 10th Church this day, bearing witness to your great name through medical missions, through the efforts of education, through the witness of the word by preaching and teaching. We pray for these. We pray that you would supply their every needs. We pray that you would help them in areas of learning about the culture and the language and the study of the peoples that they serve. We pray that they would become versatile in these areas so that they become good witnesses by faith in Jesus Christ. Remember today the Columbia short-term mission work that goes on even from our own midst, those who are serving there today. Wilt thou bless and keep them from all harm and danger and injury, we pray. We pray for this congregation. We pray for those needs which each of us respectively bring before you, whatever they may be, those areas of loneliness or doubt, fears, those areas of spiritual depression or anxieties or worries about employment or unemployment or areas of health or aging. Lord, we thank you that you are a great balm in Gilead and are able to help us in each of these areas. Help us to cast every care upon you, for you do care for us. And we remember this day also the president of our own country, for the military officials and the major decisions that they are to make. Give them good wisdom and counsel in the ways that they will interact with each other, but also within the spheres of leadership throughout our world this day. We pray for peace in our world. We pray that Jesus Christ would be lifted up, that he would be greatly honored in lands where that gospel will go forth, and we pray that you would forbid the spread of evil and those forces that would cause harm or injury to your creation, we pray. especially for your own. Won't you protect them? The persecuted church around the world, we pray that you would be gracious and help them. Father, on this Lord's Day, this day that we remember the resurrection of Jesus Christ, help us to love you this day. Help us find occasion to love one another as you have loved us. And help us to find areas to do good on this day, which even our very Savior said, that which is good we can do on this day. And we pray later for the preaching and teaching of your word in our midst. Bless your servant. Strengthen him and give him much wisdom in the areas of teaching us about yourself, growing us together as your people in grace. And for all of these things we do ask by faith in Jesus' name, amen. I want to welcome you again to 10th Church. And if you're visiting with us for the first time, please take one of the cards in the front of the pew, fill that out. We would like to note your attendance with us. If you have any questions, please drop by in the narthex. There is a visitor center where you can get information for any of those questions. But thank you for coming and joining with us today. Several announcements just to note. First of all, if you are in the 2030s category, 10th City Network will be meeting right after our service today, 12:30. Please meet out on the steps by the sign at 17th and Spruce and to share lunch together. Also, if you're from Parish 2, you have opportunities to serve in the luncheon today, community luncheon up in Fellowship Hall. They are in need of those who are help with the cooking and the serving, as well as the hosting at tables. That will be at 12:30 in Fellowship Hall. Also, Maranatha will be returning from their camping trip this afternoon, and there'll be no Maranatha this evening. And finally, the Lord's Supper will be shared next Sunday evening. Make plans for that in your schedules. We'll continue our worship with the singing of 413.
Great God, we thank you for Jesus Christ, whom you've given to us, that we can know him, that we can treasure him, that we can live our lives for him. We thank you that in him we have all that we need. We thank you that you have blessed us with every spiritual blessing in Christ Jesus. And we thank you for the many ways that you've materially provided for us, that you provided for our families, that you provided for this church. And we pray now that as we give our money to support the work of the church, that you would take that money and use it for the spread of the gospel, for the building up of the saints, for the evangelization of the city and the world. And we pray in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. I invite you to turn with me in your Bibles to scripture reading for this morning, Luke 13, 1 through 5. There should be black Bibles in the pew in front of you. It can be found on page 872 of the Pew Bibles. So Luke 13, 1 through 5. Hear now the reading of God's word. There were some present at that very time who told him about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And he answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. Are those 18 on whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them, do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you will all likewise perish."
Well, do keep your Bibles open at that passage we read from Luke chapter 13. Over these summer weeks, we're looking at a number of controversies that Jesus got engaged in, and this morning, we're looking at this issue that was raised with him concerning calamity or tragedy, disaster, catastrophe, whether they are accidents or punishments. It's an issue that regularly comes up. I heard some time ago about John Humphreys, who is one of the UK's most respected broadcasters. He regularly is on the BBC, which is the dominant radio program, and he is responsible for livening up. Frankly, the BBC always needs a bit of life. And John Humphreys manages to do that. He manages to liven it up when he's interviewing the political classes and putting them on the spot and exposing the inadequacies of their failed policies. He's a useful person to have around. But John Humphreys wrote a book not long ago called In God We Doubt, Confessions of a Failed Atheist. Unlike other people who've written on this subject, of course, he manages to sound gracious and generous to those of us who have a faith. He finds himself rather angry with those who rubbish people who believe. But in it, he tells how it was that he came to doubt the nominal Christianity with which he grew up. It was, you may remember, a siege in Russia, in Beslan, in Russia, when armed terrorists seized more than 1,000 school children and kept them hostage in that Russian school. It ended when the gunman opened fire, killing 176 of those children. Tragedy, however it appears, is hard to take, whether it's warlords butchering thousands of people in Africa, insurgents killing soldiers and civilians in Baghdad, bombers blowing up commuters on an underground train, or terrorists flying packed passenger planes into tall office buildings, or students killing their flatmate for not engaging in their violent sex party, or the hurricane that devastates the lives of many, or the tsunami that claims 250,000 victims, or a civil war like that raged for 20 years in Sudan, claiming over 2 million people, or the current massacre of Christian people who represent a community of over nearly 2,000 years in the Middle East, the beheading of little children in Iraq by ISIS, or the cancer that takes away the life of a child, or the accident that robs a young family of its mother. Human history and our daily news bulletins are full of disasters, whether they're freak accidents or fierce atrocities. In the last 1,000 years, it's estimated that 15 million people have died in natural disasters of one kind or another, including outbursts of plague. In the 20th century, 205 million people died in wars. 40 million died under the repression of Mao Zedong. 20 million under Joseph Stalin. We are surrounded by these disasters, these catastrophes, these calamities. And when these things happen, we inevitably ask the question, why? And just as soon as the question, why, is asked, there are others who are jumping up ready to give us an answer. Perhaps the worst thing that can happen when you're struggling with the question, why, are those people who rise up to give us some facile or superficial explanation for the calamities that have hit us in our lives. For others, of course, there's no answer. They have nothing to say. For still others, they've got a hotline to God, and they will tell you exactly why the thing is happening or why it has happened to you. My guess is, from John Humphrey's book, that it was some of these quick, off-the-cuff, tripping-off-the-tongue, facile answers that led to his rejection of a belief in God. Jesus will have none of those superficial answers. In this passage we've read in Luke chapter 13, a number of people come to Jesus and they have in their mind their own presupposed answer to the questions that they raise with him. And I want you to notice what Jesus does with these people. They come with their presupposition as they come to Jesus, and they point out to him, they bring to his mind, or they bring to his attention what was being already broadcast on the news waves and reported in the newspapers at the time, if they had newspapers and did have broadcasts. These tragedies that had occurred, this massacre, they told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. If it was today, they would have told Jesus about the baptized Christian children who are being beheaded and their heads put in poles outside villages in Iraq today. They drew Jesus' attention to these things because they had a presupposition in their mind. They had an idea in their head. And Jesus will not let it pass. Jesus will not allow them to have an idea that remains unchallenged. You know, sometimes you find yourself in a meeting or you find yourself in a conversation and something is said that you know instinctively is wrong. You sense it is wrong, or you sense that the thinking behind it is wrong, but actually everybody is being very convivial, everyone is being very happy, and so rather than spoil the party, you say nothing. You go home. You tell your wife or your husband what happened, usually your wife, and she says, "Why didn't you say something?" That's what they're there for, to be irritants. Why didn't you say something? You feel devastated at your foolishness or your feebleness. Well, Jesus never lets anything pass. He insists on correcting or challenging any wrong ideas that might be coming to the surface of your head. These people, they are thinking about an atrocity on the one hand and an accident on the other. In the atrocity, good, God-fearing, Bible-believing, temple-attending people are killed, massacred by Pilate. On the other hand, some quite innocent bystanders are killed by a wall that has collapsed on top of them. An accident, an atrocity. And when these things happen, our human impulse is to want an explanation. That's why we find Jesus responding to this. You notice he assumes there were some present at that very time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. Why are they telling him what he obviously knows? Well, they're doing so because they want an answer. They want an answer, and they want someone to blame. That's always the way it is when something like this happens. People want an answer, and they want someone to blame. Whether you are a religious believer on the one hand or a secular humanist on the other, you want an answer, and you want someone to blame. Jesus could have let it go. He could have ignored it. He could have decided to get on with his day, but instead he stops and he challenges it. Now this introduces us really to the issue that we're going to look at this morning. Tragedy, disaster, calamity is a problem for those who believe in God or in some idea of God. And you can respond to this in a variety of ways. You can believe in fate, for example. This is the view of one of the dominant world religions that's involved in the news right now. It is the will of God, they say. It is the will of Allah. It's a kind of fatalist approach. Nothing you can do about it. Don't ask any questions. And we have absolutely no idea what that plan is. Others respond in terms of free will. Still others put it down to personal sin. That's what these people who were speaking to Jesus, I don't think they were disciples, these people who were speaking to Jesus had come to him. And like religionists all over the world from various religions, they were inclined to believe that the sad events of the atrocity and the accident were somehow related to the specific sins in the lives of the casualties. We do that. We do that in normal life. We have an expression that we use, there is no smoke without fire. We use it indiscriminately. We use it often when we have no basis for using it. We immediately recognize what we think we see as smoke and we relate it to fire. But what we see may be mist, it may be fog, it may be steam, not smoke. But so quick are we to judge, so quick are we to reach a conclusion. We don't ask ourselves any deeper questions. There is no smoke without fire. At the time of the Asian tsunami, I read about some people. They were headbangers, Christian headbangers, I think, but they were headbangers nonetheless, who were pointing to the fact that this tsunami obviously hit that part of the Far East because of the naked sun worshippers on the one hand and the sex traffickers on the other. Completely begging the question as to why it was that in the part of the south of France where we used to go on vacation, there were plenty of naked sun worshippers, so I'm told, in beaches adjacent to the beach that we were on, and sex trafficking is going on all the time in France and in Western Europe. Facile answers to the question. On the other hand, secular humanists, they want a response. They want an answer too. They look at the atrocities and the disasters and the accidents, and they notice that they happen to good people, and they want to know why it is that good people are caught up in these things, while bad people seem very often to go off entirely free. And they have an interesting approach to this issue. They don't believe in God, of course. They are humanist, and they are secular, entirely secular. And yet the amazing thing is that whenever they find themselves locked in this kind of conversation or discussion, God will invariably sneak into the conversation. And he will be blamed, of course. God, who never gets a mention in their media for 98% of the time, suddenly makes a walk onto the stage for a moment so that he can be blamed for what didn't happen. John Humphreys is an atheist. He tells us in his book, however, that he was praying for those people in that siege in Russia that they would get out free. And when they didn't get out free, he lost his faith in the God in whom he did not believe. We laugh at it, but you know, very often when I was in the days when I was younger and was touring universities in the UK and in Europe, and we would have a Q&A, which usually took place in the cafeteria at the peak when all the students were in there getting their evening meal, we'd set up a microphone and they'd get to grill a preacher or grill a Christian. I forget how it was described. It's what some of those things. And they would ask all kinds of questions. I guarantee you the first or second question that they would ask is this: how can a good God or a loving God allow bad things to happen to good people? Even if they didn't believe in God. C.S. Lewis accepted this contradiction. He wasn't a believer either. He was an atheist. And he writes, "I maintained that God did not exist. I was also very angry with God for not existing. And I was equally angry with God for creating a world like this." Full of contradictions. All accidents and atrocities are still a problem to the secular humanist and the atheist. For if he has no God, no higher law in the universe, who is to say what is good and what is bad? What is disaster and what is not disaster? If there are no laws, if there is no absolute, if there is no moral absolute in the universe, then there is no good or bad. Violence is natural. When it happens, the earth is simply correcting itself. The victims are being put right on some principle. It's part of an evolutionary principle. It's the survival of the fittest. It's the strong grinding down the weak in order to survive. But even secular humanists have a problem with bad things happening. And so people like John Humphreys write a book about it. Well, I want to bring you to this passage this morning, and I want to ask the question, what does Jesus have to say about disasters, calamities, these kind of things that we are facing daily in our news today that are being ignored by people who should be doing something about it, perhaps, but they're on the news all the time. And I want to start by looking at what Jesus assumes. Follow with me in this. What Jesus assumes. You just need to read over the story again. It doesn't take you seconds to do that. And you notice that he does not feel the need to defend God. He doesn't question God, which seems rather hard to us. Don't we want him to do that? Regularly we find good people in the book of Psalms questioning God. Why? Why is it that the wicked seem to get to be successful and here the good just suffered under the foot of the oppressor? He doesn't say that. He comes to this and he assumes that God is in control. I want you to notice what he does. He assumes, first of all, God's sovereignty. If you go back to see the context of this story, if you go back for a moment into the previous chapter, look at that section 54 to 56, where Jesus talks about what the crowd that he's speaking to, were able to do. They were country people. They were farmers largely. And because they were farmers, they were interested in the weather. They knew how to read the weather. When you see a cloud rising in the east, the west, you say at once, a shower is coming. And it happens. And when you see the south wind blowing, you say, there will be scorching heat. And it happens. You can read that. If he was talking perhaps to an audience in London or New York or perhaps here in Philly, he might say something like this. You can read all the economic indicators. You can forecast the movement of the FTSE and the Dow averages. You guess which way your shares are going to go. But here's his punchline. How come you can read the weather? How come you can read the stock market? How come you cannot read the signs of the times? That's his challenge. And he talks to them about the sovereignty of God. His underlying understanding is, from the Westminster Confession of Faith, Jesus would approve of it, that God ordains whatsoever comes to pass. He's acknowledging, you see, that the times that they were living in were in God's hands, and those times they were living in were moving forward inexorably towards a conclusion. He is thinking particularly about himself. He's saying to the audience that he's speaking to you, the crowds, don't you see the writing on the wall? Don't you see that all this animosity that is bubbling beneath the surface in the minds and hearts of the authorities, all this animosity is going to grow and escalate to the point where they are going to put me to death. And that is part of a plan and a purpose. It is not haphazard or random. In fact, he's already warned them, and he will again and again warn them, that their very city, Jerusalem, and their country, Israel, is going to be devastated. That there's a plan and a purpose. And he assumes the sovereignty of God, that God is in control, that God has a script by which the story of humanity is working its way out. that there are no surprises to God. There are no things that take him off guard, that he is not rolling with the punches, as it were. God is ruling history according to his plan and purpose. He assumes the sovereignty of God. Secondly, he assumes the goodness of God. You can see this in the parable that immediately follows this passage. He told this parable: a man is a fig tree planted in his vineyard. He came to see fruit on it. They found none. He said to the vine dresser, "For 3 years now, I've come seeking fruit in this vine tree, and it's found none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground?" And the man answered him, "Sir, leave it alone this year also. I'll dig around it, put on manure, and see if it doesn't bear fruit next year. And if it's good, that's fine, but if not, you can cut it down." In other words, it's a lesson about the patience and the goodness of God. Why doesn't God stop the stuff humanity is doing? Why doesn't God interfere in this human story and bring everybody to justice? Why does not God get involved in humanity and resolve the issue? Jesus says he's giving humanity one more year. One more year. Instead of coming down on us like a ton of bricks, one more year for people to hear. One more year for people to respond. One more year for people to change their mind. One more year for people to repent. God is a patient, long-suffering, patient, loving-kindness God. Jesus assumes the goodness of God. These early Christians, you know, they believed in the goodness of God not by observing nature. Nature, red in tooth and claw, did not teach them about the goodness of God. They did not learn about the goodness of God by looking at humanity and thinking, if there's a God, he must be like us. Like us, who slaughter innocents in abortion clinics, who slaughter innocents in massacres in Iraq, who slaughter little children. You don't learn about the goodness of God by looking at humanity or at nature. You learn about the goodness of God. They learned about the goodness of God by looking at God in the face of Jesus Christ. They saw God there. They saw it there. And they learned the hard way that God is sovereign and that God is good, because they saw that innocent life, the life of Jesus, violently taken away from him. They saw that. They saw that life destroyed before their eyes. And after the resurrection, they discovered that when evil men had done all that they wanted to do with him and destroyed him, that nonetheless, God had used those evil men to accomplish a bigger purpose. That the very tragedy of Jesus' life was the very means that God was going to use for the salvation of men and women and boys and girls all over the world. Jesus assumes the sovereignty and goodness of God. Secondly, I want you to notice what Jesus avoids. What he avoids, you see. Jesus avoided something. Look at the story here. We know what's on their mind. They want to know who is responsible. They wanted to know who to blame for what happened. They wanted to understand what was behind the atrocity, what was behind the accident. Was God in control? Had God allowed it? They wanted someone to blame for what was going on. And I want you to notice Jesus' response. Look at this. He avoids answering that question. He avoids answering that question. Now, we need to understand what's going on here. I mean, at one level, we could say that it's not entirely clear what the motives of these people were who'd come talking about Pilate's atrocities. There was probably a political element there. Did they want to trip Jesus up into saying something that was political? You know, that's a great temptation. Jesus faced it. Every minister faces that temptation. And if you're a good minister, you do your best to avoid falling into that trap, because Session will kill you afterwards. So you don't do that. But they wanted to get rid of Jesus, and they thought if they could catch Jesus making a political point, or if the Roman authorities heard about what Jesus was saying, because they'd all have their iPhones there recording what he was saying, then they could get Jesus into trouble. That's one explanation, but it is not the explanation that's given. There's no explanation given. Jesus doesn't answer the question. He feels no obligation to defend God to God's creatures. In fact, there's more to it than that. Let's remember for a moment, let's back up just for a second. Who is it that's being asked the question? It is the Son of God. And the Son of God has two natures. You know this. The whole fundamental view that we have as believers is that there are two natures, one person. The two natures are not subsumed into each other. They're not collapsed into one another. They're distinct, but they belong to one person. Jesus is one person with two natures. It's the most amazing thing. Here is God, the eternal God, the Son of God, and he has taken human nature. It's real human nature. He is still really, really God, truly God, very God of very God, and he is really and truly human. He is made of flesh. The Word became flesh. He is made of the same stuff as you are, totally. He is as totally human as you are, and he's as totally God as he is. God is. And it's Jesus as the God-man who is speaking. Now, get this. Sometimes Jesus acts like God when he knows what people are thinking before they say it. He knows your heart. When he takes a man who has been paralyzed all his life, and he speaks a word, the man gets up, lifts up his bed, dances around, and goes off walking. When he heals a woman who's had a long-standing illness, and instantly she's cured. When he raises the dead, when he gives sight to the blind, when he gives hearing to the deaf, Jesus is acting as God. When he feeds a multitude of 5,000 people, he is acting as God. But when he gets tired, there he is in his humanity, because God in Christ has become really human. When the crowds get too much of him and he needs space and he withdraws from them into a quiet place to rest for a while, you understand that, because he's fully human. When he stands at a graveside, even though as the Son of God he's going to raise the dead, as a human being standing at a graveside, the graveside of someone he loved, he weeps tears. He is fully human. And here in this story, Jesus is replying to these people as the man, Christ Jesus. And he's teaching us by his reply that as the man, Christ Jesus, he didn't know the answer to the question, why? Do you see that? As God, he knows everything, all the time. But in his humanity, he can even say, I don't even know the day or the hour that I'm going to come back, but my Father knows. But we also know that he says that as the Son of God, there's nothing that the Father knows that he doesn't know. Father tells him everything. So as the Son of God, as the eternal Son of God, he knows everything. But as the man Christ Jesus, he knows what you know. And what you know is this. When bad things happen, you don't know why. And it's above your pay grade to make up an answer, because humans don't understand. You see, there's a Bible principle that goes way back into the Old Testament. The secret things belong to the Lord our God, and the revealed things belong to us. Here is Jesus in his humanity, and he feels under no obligation to defend God or to come up with an answer. He doesn't make up an answer. The people who come to you and they make up answers are not helping you. Let me tell you that. They are not helping you when they come making up answers. That's what the book of Job is in the Bible. In the book of Job, you have Job and his friends are coming up with this answer, that answer, the other answer. Job himself is coming up with his complaints and his own answers. And at the end of the day, God turns up and speaks to Job and hurls at him about 138 questions, asking him, where were you when I did this and when I did that and when I did the next thing? Job is left silent. He can't speak. He has nothing to say. He's learned that there is no way that as a human being you know or could grasp or could get your head around or could articulate the answer. Why are these things happening? But as clearly as Jesus avoids giving an explanation, as clearly as he avoids giving an explanation, he avoids putting the blame on the individuals. Do you notice that? He dismisses out of hand any suggestion that these people who are caught up in these disasters were greater sinners than anybody else. He refuses to draw a direct line between their personal sin and this terrible disaster. And he does that for two reasons. That once you do that, you're losing sight of the reality of universal sin and universal death. Jesus does not deny that these people were sinners. He doesn't say they were innocents. He doesn't use that language. We use that language wrongly sometimes. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Nobody's innocent. But he refuses to draw a line between what happened to these people and their personal sin. He refuses. He avoids that entirely. Now, more positively, what does Jesus argue? We've seen what he assumes, what he avoids, now what he argues. He argues, first of all, that every one of us lives our life under the shadow of death. The statistics on death are impressive. One out of one people dies. It's a reality. Nothing changes. Nothing changes when there's a car bomb or a tsunami or a boating accident or a war or a massacre. Nothing changes. The death rate does not change. Oh yes, tens, scores, or thousands of people may be tragically swept away all at once. But every one of them, like every one of us, was going to die. Each of the numbers coming out of Africa or Iraq represents the very personal loss of a brother or sister or father or mother or grandfather or grandmother or son or daughter. Every human death diminishes the world. The death of one individual matters to God. That one individual captures within themselves a universe of thought and imagination and memory and experience and longings and hopes and wishes and desires. You, as an individual, you are a universe to yourself. You are significant in yourself. You are worthy in yourself because God has made you in his image. Nothing small happens when one human being dies. And though we may hear massive numbers, they are massive numbers of one human being dying, who has significance in the eyes of God. Death, the death rate, doesn't change. And behind the death rate, sin doesn't change. Because death is an alien intruder in the world, and it's only there because of sin. No sin, no death. That's true for everybody. The wages of sin is death. So that means what? That means we've all sinned, because we all die. We cannot escape sin. Sometimes it's all dressed up prettily and trendily, but it's there nonetheless. Back in the Asian tsunami, there were reports in the aftermath of Asian women and children in refugee camps being sexually abused. One teenage girl told the story of being raped by the man who moments before had pulled her from the water to safety. At the time, the Washington Post reported, those who have long worked in disaster zones say human predators are part of a pattern. The natural disaster strikes, people die, people mourn, compassion and aid roll in, and along with it, the predators. Sin is in us and in everyone. Sin is more than personal. It is global. It is cosmic. Sin throws nature out of joint. The natural world is not immune from human sin. Hence, there are these natural disasters. Jesus argues that. And then he argues that we live in a world under judgment. So we all better repent. Every deadly calamity, every concentrated period of death, as well as the individual deaths of each of us, each of those moments are a merciful call of God to the living to repent. Listen to Jesus again. Do you think they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you. But unless you repent, you will all likewise perish. What he's doing there is upping the ante. He's pushing what's involved here. He's saying this: unless you repent, there will be something worse than dying happen to you. You will perish. In the language of the New Testament, there's dying and death, and there's perishing. Perishing is to be cast away from God. Perishing means to be distanced from God forever. We'll all die, but we will not all perish. To perish is to be excluded from the presence of God for eternity. That's what Jesus says. Now we ask the question, why should I listen to Jesus? And the answer is that Jesus is himself the ultimate argument for the goodness and love of God in a cruel world. Aren't we entitled to ask the question, what is God doing about death? When we find the tragedy of the world gnawing at our hearts, we wonder what the resolution is. And the first answer the Bible gives to us is to point us to God's identification with those that suffer. Now, let me put that in its context. This is not the president saying to the people, I feel your pain. This is not the rich man saying to the poor man, I know what it's like to suffer. I lost a couple of million in the stock market crash, you know. When God says he identifies with us, he actually did something about it. The whole message of Christmas is about what God did about it. That's just the mention of Christmas. If you've seen your e-blast, you'll know that it's been in my mind. As we discovered that I was responsible for the largest single component of the stuff that needed moved out of our big house into our small house. And it was the Christmas decorations. And I'm perfectly willing to share them with the church to do something about that tree. But that's another matter altogether. That's naughty. But Christmas is about the incarnation. And the incarnation is about God incarnate, in flesh, that is, in what you and I live in. And it was total, real humanity. He wasn't just putting on fancy dress as a human. He wasn't just pretending to be human. He wasn't just taking up some human elements into himself. He became fully, truly human. That's what we mean when we sing in the carol, veiled in flesh, the Godhead. See, here is God taking into himself an alien component, something that was never in the Godhead before, taking human flesh into the Godhead, so the Godhead, through the Son of God, feels everything that we feel. He feels in entirety what we feel. There is nothing, no limitation, no pain that he does not feel. In every pain that wrings the heart, the man of sorrows has a part. Dorothy Sayers wrote this: for whatever reason God chose to make man as he is, limited, suffering, subject to sorrows and death, he had the honesty and courage to take his own medicine. Whatever game he was playing with his creation, he has kept his own rules and played fair. He can exact nothing from man that he has not exacted from himself. He has himself gone through the whole of human experience, from the trivial irritations of family life and the cramping restrictions of hard work and lack of money, to the worst horrors of pain and humiliation, defeat, despair, and death. When God was a man, he played the man. And at the end of the day, we believe in the goodness and love of God because of Jesus. Now you can see in him these two elements. You see God when you look at the miracles. You see the man Christ Jesus when you look at the cross. You see him placed on that cross and becoming a curse for us. And Jesus' divine nature is in touch with his human nature as on that cross he suffers and dies, as on in the lead up to that cross, in his human nature, he shrinks from the agony that lies ahead, ready to die, but nonetheless shrinking from it, like the old martyrs who were to be burned at the stake and who were prepared to be burned at the stake for Jesus' sake, but who nonetheless shrunk from the flames. You would do that too. Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane shrinks from it. Oh, Father, he says, will you not take this cup from me? And strengthened by his God nature, as it were, his human nature resolves to go through with this horrendous thing that lies before him. But you understand, do you, that in his human nature, he feels the sheer weight of the temptation and the test that lies before him. And on the cross, as he prays to his Father, as he seeks his Father's company and his Father's companionship in his human nature, strengthened by his divine nature, he is cast into outer darkness. He is afflicted in his human nature by all the power of hell for the sake of his people. And his human nature, strengthened by his divine nature, experiences the agony of separation from God. My God, why have you forsaken me? Here is Jesus in his humanity. And in his humanity, rising from the dead, he triumphs over death. And his triumph over death is the basis for our hope for our own resurrection from the dead, our hope for the restoration of our relationships with our loved ones, our hope for the restoration of the cosmos from all that's been made done to it. The reality is you and I can't come up with neat answers for the suffering in the world. Accidents and atrocities happen. And they're just that, they're accidents and they're atrocities. That's what they are. But they happen under the umbrella of a sovereign God who does have a purpose. I just don't know what that purpose is. But I can tell you, Jesus has done something about it. While he was here in the flesh, in his divine nature, he targeted illness. He said, in effect, to illness, to sickness, your days are numbered. And he targeted death, and by his resurrection from the dead, he said to death, you are destroyed. And he takes the sting out of death for those who believe in him. One of my Facebook friends, Duncan Rankin, a PCA minister, his father died yesterday. And in the report of his death and in the report of the family, they're looking forward to the daybreak when the shadows flee away and they see the King and his beauty and are reunited in the presence of the Lord Jesus. Jesus takes away the sting of death for the believer. Back in September 10th, 2006, Tim Keller gave a talk at a memorial service for the victims of 9/11. Presidents Bush and Clinton were there, ex-Mayor Giuliani and Mayor Bloomberg were there. The White House transcribed the talk because President Bush had asked for a copy. And towards the end of that, Tim Keller spoke about his own bout with cancer the year after the towers fell. Here's what he said. During that whole time, I read about the future resurrection, and that was my real medicine. In the last book of The Lord of the Rings, Sam Gamgee wakes up thinking everything is lost and discovering instead that all his friends were around him. He cries out, Gandalf, I thought you were dead. But then I thought I was dead. Is everything sad going to become untrue? The answer to Sam Gamgee is yes. The answer of the Bible is yes. If the resurrection is true, then the answer is yes. Everything sad is going to come untrue. Keller goes on, I know many of you are saying, I wish I could believe that. And guess what? This idea is so potent that you can go forward with that wish. To even want the resurrection, to love the idea of the resurrection, to long for the promise of the resurrection, even though you're unsure of it, is strengthening. 1 John 3, Beloved, now are we the children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope purify themselves as he is pure. Even to have that hope is purifying. Listen to how Dostoevsky puts it in Brothers Karamazov. I believe like a child that suffering will be healed and made up for, that all the humiliating absurdity of human contradictions will vanish like a pitiful mirage, like the despicable fabrication of the impotent and infinitely small Euclidean mind of man, that in the world's finale, at the moment of eternal harmony, something so precious will come to pass that it will suffice for all hearts, for the comforting of all resentments, for the atonement of all the crimes of humanity, of all the blood they've shed, and it will make it not only possible to forgive, but to justify what has happened. Can you imagine that? That last sentence. If the resurrection is true, it's absolutely right that on that day of resurrection in the presence of God, we will find it not only possible to forgive, but to justify what has happened in this life. Dr. Sangster was a famous Methodist minister in the Central Hall in London. And he had a brother who was born grotesquely deformed in body and in mind. He lived till he was six, that brother. Sangster used to say, I wondered about it as a boy, and I've struggled with it as an adult. But I know that when I reach glory, and I ask about it there, I will be happy with the explanation. Jesus doesn't give you a facile, simplistic answer to the question why. But he points you to himself. And he says, I know what it's like to ask why. Why have you forsaken me? And I know that you struggle with the limitations of not knowing the big picture. Because in my humanity, I did not know the big picture. I understand that. But as much as I am human, I am God, and one day, I will wipe away every tear from your eyes. Let's pray together. Father, you teach us from your word this morning that we must walk by faith, not by sight. And in doing so, we follow Jesus in his humanity. He walked by faith. And though our hearts break at the tragedies we see in the world, and they come in a whole variety of ways, and as some of us remember our own private little tragedies, a lost child, a lost parent, some beloved person in whom the whole world was captured for us, now gone. We pray that you would please fortify our minds and hearts today. We pray that you would please help us to lift our eyes by faith to the Lord Jesus, risen as he is, still in his humanity, and clinging to his promise, do what he says here. It's time to repent, change our mind, focus on him, and wait for glory to dawn. In his name we pray. Amen. Now may God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit guard and guide you throughout this, your brief, uncertain life and pilgrimage, and bring you safely home to glory, where there are pleasures forevermore. God be with you.